So involute gears must satisfy the fundamental law of gearing, and that means the shape of the surface of one body must be conjugate with another body, and the common normal to the points in contact must pass through or intersect with the line of centers at a certain point P. And that position of that point P must always be the same. In any other position of these two bodies in contact, the normal to the bodies must be at point P, such that if this is body 2 and that is the rotation of axis of rotation of body 2, and this is body 4, with that as the axis of rotation of body 4, omega 4 over omega 2 must always be equal to O of O2P over O4P, and it must be constant. So the shape of the outline of the bodies must be conjugate, and it satisfies the fundamental law of gearing. So consider this figure. This is a circle, and we have an imaginary string around it. And when we have to unwind this, that particular point, which is the end of that line, that string, will trace a certain curve, which is the shape of an involute. And this circle, in the nomenclature of involute gears, is called base circle. So we can have other definitions necessary for understanding of our involute gears. We will have, of course, our base pitch, or also referred to as the normal pitch. This is equal to the circular pitch. Multiplied by cosine theta. So what is now this cosine theta? Let us have other figures and other drawings to clarify these things. We will have this as the base circle, and we have our string unwound from this base circle. We will have another base circle here, and we can have another kind of string, another string which we will have to unwind from this base circle. So that will have to trace also another involute, and these two bodies must have a certain line that is tangent to this base circle and this base circle. Now we can now have this particular point here as a point P. If we have to draw this line of center, and we have to draw this perpendicular line to the line of center, this is 4, this is O4, this is 2, and this is O2. This particular angle is the pressure angle. And a while ago, we have just defined the normal pitch as the circular pitch multiplied by the cosine theta. That cosine theta is this particular pressure angle, or the theta is equal to the pressure angle. And we can also remember, or we can also notice, that this is also theta in the same way that this is theta, and they all refer to the same angle, the pressure angle. Now this line, which is tangent to the 2 base circle, will be now referred to as the line of action. Now that line of action will tell us the length or the path of contact of the 2 gears. So that is another thing that we'll have to clarify. We must remember that the normal pitch is equal to the circular pitch multiplied by cosine theta. Involute gears. And with gears, the fundamental law of gearing must be satisfied. And so with that, the shape of the bodies in contact must be conjugate. And considering these 2 bodies, body 2 and body 4, we have a point of contact C. And there is common normal that is passing through the point of contact. And that common normal intersects the line of center of the 2 bodies. That intersection is point P. Now, if we have to have a conjugate relationship, the surfaces are in conjugate shape, then omega 2 over omega 4, or omega 4 over omega 2 must be equal to O2 of P over O4P. And this must be constant. And that means for these 2 body to be conjugate at any position, a common normal must always pass through that point T. And for the design of teeth of gears, there are currently 2 standard shapes. And these 2 standard shapes are the cycloidal gears and the involute. Cycloidal gears have a lot of disadvantages over the involute. Cycloidal gears has, of course, less sliding contact, so there is less wear. But it is its manufacturing process is very difficult, and therefore it's very expensive. And when we have a design of the distance of gears, there have to be a specific distance with which these cycloidal gears must operate. Involute gears, however, are different. If we have a design of an involute gears, we can move them away from each other, or we can move them closer to each other, and it still maintain that conjugate relationship, that fundamental law of gearing. And that means the ratio of rotation of the 2 gears are constant. So another advantage of the involute gear over cycloidal gears is that of manufacturing process. Involute gears can be made with less difficulty and therefore less expensive. Now let's talk more about involute gears. We remember that involute gears must have the shape of an involute. And taking this circle, we can have this string, imaginary string, around this base circle, and we unwind this. We hold the end of the string tight, and as we unwind it, the end of the string will trace a curve, and this curve, of course, is of an involute shape.